Good morning, everyone. To our visitors, welcome. It's nice having you. Also, just would remind you that there are some goodies downstairs and coffee and cold drinks. So after the service, please stay and enjoy some food and some fellowship around the tables downstairs. A few announcements this morning. Excuse me. First of all, the offering envelopes for 2024 are down in the narthex, so please stop by and pick up yours. If you'd like to have a box for next season, Jill told me there are a couple extras, so let Jill know and she will get you a box. Sarah, are you ready for Sunday school, or would you? Okay. There is supposed to be Sunday school, but my wife kind of questioned that, so because she questioned it, and Sarah's not ready, and we will not have Sunday school this morning. Let's just stay and let's fellowship together. We will start next week, all right? All right. Next Sunday, we will also have installation of elder and deacon, so please remember that, and please join us as we install those two young men. So, all right. Also, prayer group will be at 7 o'clock on Thursday, if we're well enough to do it. We couldn't get together this past Thursday, so we're going to do it Thursday night. So I think that's all I have. There are some other announcements in the bulletin. Please check those out. So, all right. So what I envision, and I guess I didn't make myself very plain. My wife is going, yeah, you did. At this time, I'm going to ask if you brought a remembrance that you would come and just share it on the communion table. If there's no room left there, you can kind of put it on the piano or the organ. You may notice that there is a couple bouquets of flowers, and that is from Roger Eilert's funeral yesterday. So we thank the family for sharing those with us. So come on up, share your remembrances. When you get back to your seat, stay standing. We'll have our call to worship, our opening hymn, and our opening prayer. Okay? So come on up. Yeah, just move stuff around. There you go. Work? Okay. All right, we're going to talk a little bit about these things in a little later in the service. So let's stand for our call to worship and our opening hymn. And then after the hymn, there's also a prayer of response on page 45, and we'll read that together as well. So the call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 57. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the people, for great is your love. Reaching to the heavens, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above all the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 44, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have that number 45 up? Okay. All right, let's pray this in unison. I realize it's written in the form of a responsive reading, but let's do it in unison. We are here in the presence of God, stripped of pride and a false sense of our own importance. God has called us to be still in silence, to sense Spirit, the satisfaction of His presence. O fellow pilgrims, let us put our hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, Leah's going to show the pictures that have been shared with us.
Love for the Father.
I knew I was going to have to get up here after that. Let's turn to Psalm chapter 73. I'm going to read verses 21 through 28, and it's found on page 910 in your pew Bibles. And then just verse 10 from Isaiah 41. Let's ask God to bless the reading of His holy word. Father, our hearts are churning with emotion. And Lord, I believe yours is as well. For you never intended to hurt us or to upset us. But just the opposite, really. And so, Lord, we lean upon you this morning in your holy word as we read it. May your words comfort us and give us hope. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 73, 21 through 28. And as many of you know, these are some of the verses that Sue had marked in her Bible. When my heart was grieved and my soul was embittered, I was senseless and ignorant. I was a brute beast before you. Yet I am always with you. You hold me by your right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you would take me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire beside you. My flesh, my heart may fail, but God is my strength and my heart and my portion forever. Those who are far from you will perish. You will destroy all those who are unfaithful to you. But as for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Sovereign Lord my refuge. I will tell of all your deeds. And then from Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. At this time, we'll have the special music entitled, In Christ Alone. For our New Testament reading this morning, I've chosen a few verses from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And it's found on page 1840 if you'd like to read along. I'm going to read verses 13 through 18. Paul's writing to the church in Thessalonica, and the church is having some issues, if you will, with the matter of death and dying. And they're concerned or worried about how the resurrection is all going to take place, and they're worried about just a lot of things. And in some ways, their belief in Jesus himself is actually causing more questions, more issues, more concerns for them. Because they want some deeper answers. And they're not getting them. And not much has changed, has it? Since that time and us today, maybe we don't question how the resurrection is all going to happen, even though we don't totally understand it, but we have questions, don't we? Mainly why. And so Paul then writes these words, beginning at chapter 4, verse 13. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe God will bring us with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we are still alive. We are left until the coming of the Lord. We will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so that we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Amen. Let's sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus, number 625. You want to stand or you want to remain seated? No one's saying anything. Well, then let's stand, okay? Let's stand and sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. You may be seated. In Christ Alone is the title of this morning's message. It was the theme of our special music. If you noticed, when I came up, I lit the Christ candle. For Advent has now passed, and Christmas has passed, yet there is one who remains, Jesus Christ. And as I was thinking about what I wanted to share this morning and everything about that, I looked up on my shelves, and I have a few things posted there, taped up there, and the first thing I saw was Heidelberg Catechism question number one. What is your only comfort in life and in death? If Kelton was here, I was going to ask him to recite the answer because I know he could do it. But the first part of that answer, and that's as far as I'm going to go for this morning's message, is that I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. In Christ alone. It is in Christ alone that we can find peace. And I'm going to talk about that in a few moments as well. It is in Christ alone that we can find comfort, that we can find help. Oh, there are people that God puts around us to help us, but that too is from God, from Jesus Christ. But there still remains that looming question as we remember and as we reflect this morning. Why? There are some obvious answers. There are some answers that maybe are vague and leave much for the mind to wander and ponder about. But I believe maybe more importantly than the question why, so why not? Why not? You know, I've did this before. I've got stuff written down. All these things that you have brought forth this morning, and many more, I'm sure, in your homes or whatever that you did not bring. A cough drop. I don't know who shared that. That is so appropriate for what we're going through, right, as a society right now, everybody with the sniffles and everything. But things of a better time, of a happy time, of a joyous time, a time to remember. Things that God has shared with us through our loved ones who have gone on before us. That's right. God shared those people with us. Those very people are part of that answer in question number one. None of this is our own. And yet God sees fit to share them. I don't know if you were a Rush Limbaugh fan, not really so much, but he had this saying, on loan from God. On loan from God. For a time. God has been so merciful and so gracious to share these people with us, and they loved us, and we loved them so much, and that's why it hurts. Maybe that's the answer to why. Because we love them so much. Every day, I go to my phone and I go to the KLMJ website and I search through the weather and the markets and then the obituaries to see who has died. To see if someone that I know maybe died. This past week, I read that Art Wagner passed away. And Art Wagner, you guys don't know, but if you live further to the west, you know that he was a big cattle feeder in the Hampton area. He was a supporter of the beef producers. You could always find Art sitting in his chair in the cattle barn at the Franklin County Fair, willing and ready and hopeful that you would talk cattle with him for a while. But those people's names, you say, oh, Art Wagner passed away. That's too bad. Right? But when it comes down to someone that we know personally, someone that we love dearly, suddenly it takes on a whole new meaning. And I'd like us to think this morning back to Advent, even though I didn't light the four candles, and what each candle meant. The first Sunday of December, we lit the love candle. Excuse me, the hope candle. I'm getting ahead of myself. The hope candle. The hope that Paul was talking about to the church there in Thessalonica. That hope that we have, that even though at the point that we lose someone, and even to the point of where we are today, that the tears may flow, that our throat may get choked up, and all those things, all those emotions, even though we sorrow, there is hope because of Jesus Christ. For us as believers, death is not the end. It is the beginning, a commencement, if you will, of a new era, a new phase of our loved one, a phase, an era that will never end, that it will go on, and that as these things of remembrance bring a smile and joy to our hearts, they are in heaven right now, enjoying a joy that we cannot imagine. So hope. The second candle was the candle of peace. A peace that deep down in our hearts we can feel, can't we? Even though maybe the tears are flowing down our cheeks, there is a peace there. There is a peace there for our loved ones. Even though in those final moments death was very near, they could enjoy, they could experience that peace. Yesterday at Roger's funeral, I talked about knowing the voice of the Savior. That voice that comes to us during the good and the bad, the thick and the thin. And even that voice that we will hear when our time upon this earth is done and when Jesus will call us home. We know that voice that calms us, that assures us, that brings us peace. A peace that is not like anyone else in this world can experience except through Jesus Christ. And then the morning of our program, our Christmas program, we had the joy candle. That joy that we have, that joy that we experience with our loved ones at family gatherings or wherever it may be. That joy that we will experience when we are together with them one day in heaven. And then finally, the last Sunday of Advent, we lit the love candle. And I shared with you that love is in Christ alone, for Jesus alone is true love. That love that bounds us together, that bonds our hearts, our minds, our emotions together. God's word says, as believers, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we rejoice with those that rejoice, we weep with those that weep. And that is the epitome of the Reformed Church of Stout. I've told you that many times. That is really your calling point, your love for one another, for the world around you. So we had love, and we had peace, we had hope, and we had joy in Jesus Christ, in Christ alone. In Christ alone, we can get through these difficult times. Some of you, your loved one has been gone many years. Some of you, the wound is very, very new. There's not even a scab yet. I want to ask you a question this morning. Why are you here? It's a pretty deep question. And I'll have to say, for the first 40 years of my life, even though I wasn't with my mom and dad in their house, the reason I came to church, the reason I went to church is because that's what mom and dad taught me to do. I went to church. Sunday morning, Sunday night, as we talked about downstairs, I did not question my mom and dad. It was time to go to church. I went to church. And then after I got married, it's like, well, I got to keep going to church because, well, mom and dad will be there, and if I'm not there, they're going to wonder, right? The other people are going to wonder. I had what I would call shirt tail salvation. I knew the story, the gospel story. I was taught it well. It was ingrained into my memory. I knew that Jesus Christ came and died for my sins. I had been baptized. I had made confession of faith. I had been checking all the boxes. But my faith was not in Christ alone. My faith was in all them other things. All those things that distracted me from the real truth. And then one day in the Ackley paper, I read this, and I won't mention the church because I'm not here to try to tear that church down, but they had an ad in the Ackley paper in a little box that it was really noticeable, wanted pew fillers. Yeah, pew fillers. I thought, boy, that's a pretty neat idea, right? We want pew fillers. And then a couple weeks later, I was talking with the pastor of that church, and he says, I wish I would have never put that in the paper. And I says, why not? I mean, right? We want people to come to church. He says, no, I should have put in that ad, wanted heaven fillers. He says they can come to church, they can sit in the pew, they can do all those things. But if they don't know Jesus Christ, in Christ alone, all they are pew fillers. So I ask you again, why are you here this morning? I get a chance 2 days in a row to ask these pointed questions. These questions that normally in the Reformed Church, not just this church, but any church, we don't ask very often, right? You know what question I'm going to ask? Are you saved this morning? Are you here because of Christ alone this morning? Are you here for some other reason? Those reasons can be good. They can be wonderful. They can lead you to Christ. But if you're only there for here for those reasons, your death is coming. My death is coming. We don't like to think about it. We don't like to talk about it. But it's coming. Unless Jesus comes real soon, we're all going to die. And at that point, there's two choices. There's being with Him forever in glory, or there's hell. And that are the only two choices. Coming to church will not save you. I told the congregation yesterday that just coming to church isn't going to save you. Now, I want you all to come back next Sunday, okay? Because it's important, but it will not save you. you may come because I invited you. Some of you are outsiders and I invited you and I'm glad you came. You may have come because, well, that's what mom and dad always did. You may have come because, well, it's the right thing to do. On Sunday, we come to church. But I would ask as you leave this morning that you would leave in Christ alone. And if you have not made that commitment to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I would ask you to do so. It can be daunting to do that. It can be daunting to come before the elders and say, I'd like to make confession of faith. It can be really daunting to stand up here on a Sunday morning and have me ask you some questions. But I promise you, it won't be that daunting. We will be rejoicing with you if you come to us and ask us to make confession of faith with you. But even more so, Christ will be rejoicing. And with Christ rejoicing, I believe our loved ones who have gone on before will be rejoicing as well. Because as Paul says, one day Jesus Christ is going to come. The dead in Christ are going to be risen, and those that remain that are faithful to Him, we are all going to be gathered together in the glory of God our Father and His Son Jesus Christ. If our loved ones could come back today and say or give just one piece of advice or just one question, I know they would all say, do you know the Jesus that saved me? In that alone can we find our hope, our peace, our joy, and our love. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. Lord, as we reflect and as we remember, as our hearts again are broken, as the tears roll down our faces, because we miss these dear souls that you have called to be with you in glory. We miss them because we love them so very much. And Lord, even now we thank you. We thank you for sharing them with us. For that brief moment of time that you gave them to us, we say thank you. And Lord, may that legacy that they have left, may that legacy continue on in our families. May we have seen and learned from them. Lord, they planted seeds of salvation. They prayed for us. They taught us. They did so much for us. Lord, I would pray now that your Holy Spirit would give the increase to those seeds. And Lord, I thank you that we can pray this with confidence and hope because we know your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray it in His precious and holy name. Amen. Norma's going to come and share with us about the hymn, Does Jesus Care?
And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age, Matthew 28:20. Frank E. Greff, author of this hymn text, knew what it was to wonder, as most of God's children do at times, if the Lord is really concerned during our times of hurt When the burdens and cares weigh heavily, when the way seems dark, when temptation seems difficult to resist, or when we must part with our dearest loved one. Yet the answer comes back triumphantly, I know my Savior cares. Known as the Sunshine Minister of the Methodist denomination in the churches of the Philadelphia Conference, Frank Greff was widely liked for his cheerful and winsome personality. C. Austin Miles, writer of the hymn In the Garden, said of him, "He is a spirited optimist, a great friend of children. His bright, sunshining disposition attracts not only children, but all with whom he comes in contact. He has a holy magnetism and a childlike faith." Unknown to others, however, were the many severe testing experiences in Mr. Greff's life. It was during a time of severe physical agony, doubt, and despondency that he turned to the scriptures for comfort and strength. 1 Peter 5:7, which says, "Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you," became especially meaningful to him in this time of need. He wrote the lines of "Does Jesus Care?" to express the feelings of assurance that came to him. Mr. Greff wrote more than 200 hymns in his lifetime, but none has been more consoling to God's people than this text.
So let's stand and let's sing, "Does Jesus Care?"
Thank you.
You may be seated. Jesus does care, and he cares about those in our lives that are going through difficult times. We have the prayer concerns and praises in our bulletin. I'd also like to add that Nolan's cousin was airlifted to Iowa City yesterday with kidney and liver failure, fluid on different things on his lung. Just pray for him. Carl Davis, right? Is that? Yes. So we'll pray for Carl in his situation. Does anyone have anything else? Yeah, Roger. Yep. Okay. Well, we praise God that Larry Dreesman has responded at least somewhat to the treatments, and we just pray that God will continue to bless him. Anything else? If not, let's bow before our Lord. Let's come to him. Father, we come before you, and Lord, we have a confidence that you do care, that you love us. And Lord, even before we speak these words, you know what we're thinking, and you are already working on a solution, your solution. Lord, we thank you for the promise of new life. We pray that you will be with Kim and with Emily and others, Lord, who are expecting the birth of a new child. Lord, we just thank you. We praise you for that promise, and we pray that you will be with them. Be with those ladies and their babies, Lord. I pray for safety and health for them. Lord, we just thank you again for that promise. We thank you for being with so many that we have prayed for in the past. And Lord, we continue to pray for them. We think of Don Graves and Don DeGroat and Norm Veniga, Wayne Arntz, Leanne Kammeyer, Noreen Falkers, Larry Weiss, Dwayne Johnson, Sandy Bruins, Larry Dreesman. Lord, our list is long. But Lord, we know that you are all-powerful and that you are watching over each of them. We pray for blessing and healing if it be your will. Lord, we just pray that you'd be with many of us who are dealing with the COVID and the other viruses that are going around. We would pray for healing, Lord, for that. We think of Nolan's cousin, especially this morning. We would pray that you'd be very near and dear to him and the rest of his family as he goes through this trial. Lord, we think of many who are hurting because they have recently lost a loved one. Lord, we think of Dave Eilerts and his family. Lord, we just pray that you will bless them. Lord, we thank you for Roger's strong faith. And we pray for others, Lord, who need your hand of mercy and love. Lord, this can be a very difficult time of this year during the holidays. And we just pray that you would be with every one of them. Lord, we pray again for our shut-ins, for Eunice and Lois and Carrie. We pray that you will be with them. We thank you, Lord, for their service to you when their bodies allowed. And we thank you even today for the life that you are giving them. Lord, may you bless them. We thank you again, Lord, for putting us here in the United States of America. We thank you for our freedoms. We thank you, Lord, for those who are serving our country to protect and to serve us. Lord, our military, our police, so many others, Lord. We just thank you for them and their willingness to help out. Lord, I just pray that you'll be with us as a Reformed Church of Stout in the upcoming year. Lord, will you bless us? May you draw us closer to you. May we be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ, each and every day. And Lord, may we go forth with that prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As our deacons bring forth this morning's offering, let's stand for our doxology and offertory prayer. Lord, you have blessed us with so many things. And Lord, now we bring back just a small portion of the material things that you give us each and every day. We thank you, we praise you, and we ask that you would use these gifts to the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is number 754, God of the Ages. Hear God's benediction, and now may the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent, one from the other, and all God's people said, Amen. One of the greatest blessings I believe that God gives us is family. And so we're going to sing about the family of God. Number 75 out of the old Brown hymnals, so the words will be up on the screen.